Good morning to everyone. Hoping that all are safe. I invite all of you to join this webinar. This webinar is based on advanced surveying by using total station and GPS by Sri G. Nagesh Kumar Garu. Nagesh Kumar Garu completed his graduation in 1986 with specification of civil engineering from Geetham College. He also completed his PG in 2005. From JNTU-CE Anantapur. Currently, he is a part-time scholar with SVCU Tirupati. Under the guidance of Dr. C.H. Sudharani, his area of work is concrete and replacement with industrial waste and engineering applications. Currently, G. Nagesh Kumar Garu working as a senior assistant professor in G. Pullareddy Engineering College, Kurnool. He also published 15 papers and so many books. And he attended almost 3 national and international conferences. Now I request Nagesh Kumar Garu to start the session.
Hello. Good morning, everybody. Am I audible?
Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Am I audible?
Sir.
Okay. Is my PPT shared?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Good morning, everybody. Now I will start about this webinar.
Okay, sir.
Advanced surveying. Ms. Priya is explained about me. Thank you very much, Priya. And I am teaching this subject several times in engineering college as well as the polytechnic, and I had also wrote the books on surveying and advanced surveying, which has been published by the Falcon Publishers Hyderabad for the diploma holders. These books has been published, and our topic will be on the advanced surveying. Before going to the advanced surveying, first we'll learn about the concept of surveying. Okay, now I had gone for the first slide. That is concept of surveying. The basic concept of surveying is to collect the data about the points on the surface of the earth, prepare plans, maps, calculate areas and volumes, and transfer points from plan to the ground. This is the basic concept of surveying. That means you have to collect the data by using the various types of instruments on the surface of the earth and prepare plans or maps. And from the prepared plans and maps, you can able to draw the cross sections, longitudinal sections and cross sections, and you can able to calculate the areas of the fields as well as the volume of the earthworks made for the canals or roads, whatever may be, dams, etc., and transfer the points from plants onto the ground. After preparing the plants, suppose a building plan is prepared, this building plan is executed on the ground with the help of these drawings prepared from the surveying. And then again, setting out of the works will be the important point we have to consider in the surveying. Hence, surveying is the very important topic. Without surveying, a civil engineering cannot exist. The starting of the civil engineering work will be with the surveying only. And next, surveying is essential in all civil engineering activities, including the construction of buildings, bridges, roads, railways, pipelines, dams, ports and harbors, etc. Engineering projects cannot commence without survey data, that is planning and execution of the engineering projects. Hence, surveying is the very important topic. I hope almost all the students, second year and third year and final year, already studied about the basic surveying, and just I introduced the concept of surveying. Now I will go for the advanced surveying. Next topic is advanced surveying. the advanced surveying today, I want to learn you about the total station and its usage and application, how and what are the capabilities of the total station, and how it can be useful for engineering besides the ordinary surveying instruments like leveling and theodolite and compass surveying, etc., which are all replaced by the total station. So we will learn in detail about the total station today, and also we'll also study the advanced surveying topic, which is burning and done by the almost all engineers today practicing as GPS, global positioning system. So two topics I will cover in this session. Already I think 15 to 20 minutes delay is there in the starting. Shall I know how much time I can take, because about 70 slides are there. Harish, are you audible? Hello, Harish.
Sir, tell me, sir. Sir, tell me.
Okay.
Sir, 1 hour, 15 minutes like this.
Okay.
Take your time, sir. No problem.
No problem. So, okay, very good. Good arrangement you had made. And
yes, sir.
Go for the first type of instrument is a Topcon total station. This is a total station made by the Japan. Topcon total station. And can you able to see the drawing at here? The photographic view of the instrument showing the component parts. I will start from the bottom. From the top. This is top one is called sighting collimator, and a handle is there at the top, handle to hold the instrument, and a sighting collimator is there. Battery locking cover is there. Onboard battery is there. This is battery locking cover. This is lock is there. And instrument center mark is marked at here. Instrument center mark is marked, and horizontal tangent screw and horizontal clamping screw. As like the theodolite, it will be consisting of the horizontal clamp and horizontal tangent screw. In the theodolite, you will be having a lower clamp and upper clamp, but here only one horizontal clamp is there and one tangent screw is there instead of the theodolite. And power supply is provided at here. Power supply connector is provided. So when you are operating in the laboratory, you can connect the power supply also. And a serial signal connector. So the data from the system, that is a total station, to the computer is connected by the serial signal connector. And next, coming to the left side parts are there. That is a telescope focusing knob. As like in the dumpy level and theodolite, focusing knob is provided at here. Not at this side, at the after the eyepiece, telescope eyepiece, it is provided. So both are at the hand level. Both are at the hand level, and telescope grip is provided at here. You should not touch the telescope anywhere. Grips are provided. Two fingers you can use for rotating the telescope, both in the horizontal plane as well as the vertical plane can be rotated by holding your two fingers on the telescope grip, and vertical clamp will be provided. Vertical motion clamp is there, and vertical tangent screw is there. As like in the theodolite, it will be provided at the top. Clamp is provided at the top, and tangent is provided at here. But at here, both are provided one above the other. So once you have locked, then only the tangent will work. And next, a plate level is provided, most probably plate level, and a display unit is also provided at here. Display unit. And display unit, most probably for working purposes in the colleges, two display units are provided. One on the either side of the instrument may be provided, so that you can easily understand how one master is doing on one side, and another side student can able to read the readings. So operation can be easily understandable. And at the bottom, leveling head is provided. Leveling head provided with the tri-batch, tri-wet. And a clamp will also be there, so that the leveling head with this clamp, by opening this clamp, the leveling head and the instrument may be separated into two parts, so that the leveling head consists of a circular bubble, so that tripod adjustment can be made with the leveling head, and the foot screws can also be adjusted. After that, we can put the instrument, so that leveling operation will be completed within 2 minutes. Now we'll go for the definition of theodolite. What is a theodolite? What is the difference between ordinary theodolite and the total station? So electronic theodolites are combined and interfaced with EDMs and electronic data collectors. They become total stations or electronic tachometers. We can also call it as a electronic tachometer. And it consists of two things. One is EDM. Another thing is electronic data collector. Two parts are there. One part is EDM. EDM means electronic distance measuring instrument. EDM, electronic distance measuring instrument, and electronic data collector. So whatever may be the angles or distances measured in the instrument will be collected by using the microprocessor. So processing unit is there inside the total station. These total stations can read and record horizontal and vertical angles together with the slope distances. So total station can read both the horizontal angles as well as vertical angles together with the slope distances can be measured. These are operated using multifunction keyboard, which is connected to a microprocessor built into the instrument. So this operated by the multifunction keyboard. So already you had seen the keyboard. That is most probably correct days, keyboards are also touch screen keyboards are available. In the next slide, I will show the touch screen keyboard also instrument. And old instruments, about 10 to 15 years back instruments will be having a keyboard like your old Nokia phone. That means multifunctional keys will be there. And functional keys are additional, functional keys. F1, F2, F3, F4, four functional keys are provided for this instrument. If you observe the instrument, you can find it once. So these yellow buttons marked right here is a functional keys, and keyboard is at here. Keyboard is provided on the side of the instrument. And the microprocessor in the total station can not only perform a variety of mathematical operations, can also store observations directly using a internal memory. So this instrument acts like a mini computer, so that the microprocessor built in the total station can not only perform a variety of mathematical operations, also can perform the can also store the observations directly using its internal memory. So it will be consisting of memory, and memory can be transferred to the computer. And modern instruments will be having a pen drive slot is also provided. That is USB slot is also provided, so that data can be directly downloaded to the USB. And also ultra modern instruments of total stations will be having a connectivity with the office, so that Windows Office may be provided, so that the data can be directly transferred from instrument to the office by using the network, mobile network. Like that, my mobile network, once you have recorded the readings will be directly transferred to the office, so that once you have completed your work, that information will be sufficient for the office fellow to calculate and prepare the plans and drawings, etc. Next, clear. A total station is a two instruments in one. So it consists of two instruments. What are those? A theodolite. It consists of a theodolite. So this theodolite is also electronic theodolite, which is a device for measuring the angles very accurately. How much accuracy? Maybe about 5 seconds. And reading will be displayed for up to 1 second, but most probably ordinary total stations will be having a accuracy up to 5 seconds, reading of accuracy up to 5 seconds of the arc. you know what is a second? 60 seconds equal to 1 minute, 60 minutes equal to 1 degree, 360 degrees in a full circle. So 360 divided by 60 minutes equal to 1 degree. So 3600 part of a degree equal to 1 second. So about 1 second, it will show the display on the screen, but it can measure accurately up to 5 seconds. So it measures the angle up to up and down from the horizontal, called as vertical angle, and also the angle from a fixed reference direction can be called as a horizontal angle or azimuth. So you can able to measure the bearing also by fixing the bearing. But however, the total station doesn't consist of a compass built within it, because it is an electronic instrument. Compass cannot be operated perfectly. So by using ordinary compass, you can fix the azimuth, that is north direction, with reference to north direction. If you take the horizontal angles, those angles will become as a bearings of the lines. So you can able to measure the horizontal angle and the vertical angle or bearing by using the theodolite, which is built in a total station. And it also consists of the second device, an electronic distance measurement device. We'll call it as a EDM. Works by sending out pulses of light to a reflecting target. So this EDM works by sending a pulses of light. Maybe most probably the instruments will generate a infrared rays, or and infrared rays will be generated from the instrument station, and those will be reached to the target. Target may be a prism. Target may be a prism, the Porro prism. It is called as a Porro prism. It will reflect back these light rays, and these light rays are read by the microprocessor, and based on the time taken to travel these signals from the instrument station to the target reflector, the time difference, that is the phase difference, will be calculated. Based on that one, the distance can be calculated from the instrument station to the reflecting target. So double the distance can be obtained, and this will be divided by 2, gives the exact distance by the instrument. So this is the principle behind the EDM. I will explain the principle with a figure in the consecutive slides. So a total station is a consisting of a 2 instruments. One is a theodolite, electronic theodolite, and a next one is an electronic distance measuring device. Next, one more variety of total station, which I had shown on this figure, is a Trimble total station, and its nomenclature, there is a component parts are been explained with 2 to 3 figures. This is a touch screen type of a total station, which we are having 2 numbers in our laboratory. That is a eyepiece. This is a eyepiece and focus adjustment, same as usual as about the earlier instrument, that is a trim Topcon total station. And it will be having a vertical movement and a horizontal movement. This instrument doesn't have a clamp screw. Only tangent screw is provided. Auto clamping is there. Auto clamping is there. The major problem with this earlier instrument will be, once if you clamp and rotate the instrument, the axis will fail. That is a major drawback with the earlier instruments. And this instrument, Trimble instrument, doesn't have a clamp, so that only tangent screw is provided. So rotation can be done by the hand itself, and slow motion can be done with the vertical motion screw and horizontal movement screw. No clamp is there. Alphanumerical cue board is there. Alphanumerical cue board is provided, as like in the earlier case, and touch screen is also provided here. Both the functions, that is via media, both are available, touch screen and functional keyboard is provided. And at the bottom, tri-batch is provided. In this instrument also, we can able to detach the tri-batch and the instrument. So that after doing the leveling of the tri-batch, then only you can put the instrument over the surface. And it will be having a projected handle so that even in the vertical plane, 180 degrees can be measured. In the earlier instrument, the handle is not at the exactly at the top. So we cannot measure from the mines. A mine will be generally a vertical one so that from the bottom of the mine, you cannot take the reading. When you go for inside of the mine, the depth cannot be measured. So for that purpose, in this instrument, a projected handle is provided so that even you can read the 180 degrees depth can also be measurable. And it consists of a telescope, line of collimation, that is a plus mark is provided right here, and a battery. Yeah, it consists of two batteries so that even one is working, another can be chargeable at the outside. So that it consists of a flexibility regarding the battery. On the other side of the instrument, other side will be having a simple screen. So leveling operations, etc. can be done right here. And a physical bubble is provided right here, physical circular bubble. No plate bubble is provided, only circular bubble is there. And track lights are provided right here, track lights. So that this track light will be projected by electronically so that approximately you can coincide the target. So target fellow or the instrument man can easily adjust the instrument by using this track light. And at the top, a bullseye eye is provided. Top of the instrument, bullseye eye is provided at the top, and telescope is provided. These are the components. And on the other side of the instrument, you can find that pen drive slot is there, PC connector. Personal computer connection is also provided. Pen drive slot is there. So USB 2.0 is provided, and data transfer can be done from this box. And laser plumbage is provided. Laser plumbage so that station point can be exactly marked on the ground. And the second battery is provided on this side. Hope you are well understood about this instrument components. Now we'll go for the next. How the total station will work briefly, because once we have to see the instrument, operate it, then only you can clearly understand how to take the readings, etc. Now I will explain the capabilities of the total station, angle measurement, and electronic theodolite of total station is used to measure angles. All the features of electronic theodolite are applicable to total stations. Next is distance measurement. So electronic theodolite of a total station used to measure the angles. All the features of electronic theodolite. Electronic theodolite is a via medium instrument in between the theodolite and the total station. So only horizontal and vertical angles can be measured by using the electronic theodolite, which has been at the 1980s, this electronic theodolite is there. Nowadays only total stations are there. And second capability is distance measurement. Generally, a total station measures a slope distance. So from the instrument to the target, the slope distance is measured. And the microprocessor uses the vertical angle recorded by the theodolite along with the line of sight to calculate the horizontal distance. So the slope distance is measured by the instrument, and based on the vertical angle recorded by the microprocessor, theodolite, the microprocessor computes the horizontal distance and also height from the height distance between the Tonian axis of the prism center is also calculated and displayed. So both horizontal distance, vertical distance can be calculated by the microprocessor upon measurement of the slope distance as well as the angle, vertical angle. Next, all the total stations are coaxial optics in which the UDM transmitter and receiver are combined with the theodolite telescope. So it will be consist of a coaxial optics provided, EDM transmitter, and receivers are combined with the theodolite telescope. So it is attached to EDM, it is attached to the theodolite telescope. So that once you rotated the telescope in the horizontal plane or in the vertical plane, then also that EDM is combined with that one. So both EDM values as well as the horizontal angle and vertical angles may be measured. There are three modes are usually available for distance measurement. They are horizontal distance mode, vertical distance mode, and the sloping distance mode. Most probably, we have to use the sloping distance mode. From the sloping distance mode and vertical angle measurement, horizontal and vertical distances can be calculated by the microprocessor automatically. Now, we'll see the measurement principles of EDM instrument. Because once you have studied about one instrument, what is the principle you will ask? The principle of the measurement device in EDM used in a total station is that it calculates the distance by measuring the phase shift during the radiated electromagnetic wave, such as infrared light or laser light or microwaves, from the EDMs to main unit, EDM's main unit, which returns by being reflected through the reflector, which is positioned at a measurement point. So it will do, already I had explained this principle that EDM transmits the some rays instead of some rays. That here is clearly mentioned that electromagnetic waves radiated from the instrument, and these electromagnetic waves are reflected back by the target, which is kept at the measurement point. As like your leveling staff, this instrument will be kept at the measuring point, which point reading you require. And there you have to put this point. This instrument, that is prism, will be kept at there, so that from the reflected back, these rays are reflected back to the EDM. And this phase shift is calculated by the instrument, that is the microprocessor of the instrument. This phase shift can be regarded as a part of the frequency that appears as the unit of time or length under the specific condition. So from that one, you can able to calculate the time. From the time, the length will be displayed on the screen. Now you can observe this photograph. This indicates the principle of the EDM. EDM or total station is kept at this top of the hill, and reflector is kept at the the reflector is kept at the bottom of the hill. So A is a point, known point. A is a known point whose benchmark or elevation as well as the longitude, latitudes are known. And B is a unknown point. B is a unknown point. So there we have to put the reflector on it with a tripod or with a prism pole. The reflector may be mounted on a tripod or maybe a pole, just like your staff. And holder has to hold it and properly vertically. And this prism pole will be consisting of a bubble. So that bubble should be at the center of its run, so that this prism pole will be kept vertically. And from the EDM, the rays will be sent. After sighting, if you press a measure button in the EDM, press a measure button on the EDM, the rays will be transmitted from the EDM and reflected back in the same path. And the angle may be about 20 degrees maximum will be permitted. Even though the reflector is kept vertically, the reflection can be made very easy. Otherwise, a reflector can be bent a little bit, no problem. And this L is measured by the instrument, EDM. And from the L, it can able to calculate the S is the distance. This is L is the sloping length. And from that one, S is calculated. And also V will be calculated by the microprocessor. V is the vertical elevation difference from the center of the instrument axis to the center of the prism, that is V. And this distance is from A to B, horizontal distance. S is from instrument center to the reflector center. So for S, there is no problem. For calculation of the elevation of point B, with reference to elevation of point A. Elevation of point A plus height of the instrument. This has to be measured and fed in the instrument with the tape. With the tape up to the center of the instrument. Already while explaining the instrument, I had shown the center point of the instrument. So from the ground level to the center point, this reading should be entered into the EDM. And then, so this is height of instrument, nothing but a height of instrument measured with the tape and enter as a data into the EDM. Next, this vertical distance is calculated. V is calculated, V equal to L sin theta plus or minus. Because if the reflector is at a higher elevation, then V will be positive. And if it is below, minus V is there. And height of reflector minus height of reflector. So elevation of point B equal to elevation of point A plus HI, height of instrument, minus V minus HR, height of reflector. We'll use the elevation of point B. So the slope length L and the slope angle pi are measured by the EDM. This pi is measured. Based on that one, it can able to calculate the V and S. Sin theta, cos theta. Very simply. Sin theta is V. Cos theta is S. L sin theta, L cos theta. If it is a elevation, this is a angle of depression. So V is minus, that is L sin theta is minus value. Minus HR. Ahead of reflector. We'll use that one. Are clear about this principle, very important from EDM point of view. Next, the range of total station is typically 1 to 3 kilometers to a single prism, assuming good visibility. So by using the theodolite, you can measure up to 100 to 300 meters. Its range is only 100 to 300 meters. A very good instrument may be having more, not more than 1 kilometer. So you can have, you cannot afford more than that one. So most probably theodolites are 20,000 to 25,000 rupees. Today available in the market, may be having 100 to 300 meters range. So within your ground only, you can able to use them. So longer distances, it is not possible. But by using a total station, you can typically measure from 1 to 3 kilometers based on the lens provided to it. So cost effectiveness is there in the total station based on the lens. As like you are, whenever you are purchasing the spectacles, good company lens will be having a 2000 rupees, ordinary lens will be having a 200 rupees. So 10 times more. So a good company lens is provided for the instrument, can able to typically measure up to 3 kilometers with a single prism. That means at the target point, if we can put one prism, will be sufficient. The precision of a typical total station is 5 mm. So it can measure the distance, both horizontal and vertical or slope distances, up to 5 millimeters accurately. The distance readings are automatically corrected for atmospheric effects such as pressure and temperature. So the readings which may be read by the instrument are standardized and at the standard temperature and pressure. If your location based on the climatic condition, the temperature and pressure are variable. So if both are variable, then the microprocessor adjusts this automatically and will correct it and gives the correct values based on the corrections given by the instrument program itself. And it consists of a control panel. The total station is activated through its control panel. So it consists of a keyboard and multiple line liquid crystal display, that is LCD. LCD and modern instrument will be having a touch screen. So the touch screen is rugged generally. It can be long last for more than 10, 15 years, even though I am using this instrument that touch screen to Trimble total station more than from 10 years. So from 10 years also, it was not damaged. The touch screen, even 10 batches of students means 120 into 10, 1200 students operated it. Even though the touch screen is not spoiled. So that is the capability of the display unit. And LCD is moisture proof, can be illuminated, and some LCDs incorporate contrast controls to accommodate different viewing angles. And next, some of the total stations have two control panels, one on each face. Already have shown that two units are there. So one, to make them easier to use, angles and distances are usually recorded electronically in a digital form as raw data. On numeric keyboard, codes are represented by numbers, whereas the keyboards with feature codes are also available. So codes are also available in the keyboard. Next is power supply. Rechargeable nickel cadmium batteries are used for the power supply. The usage limit, usage time is 2 to 10 hours. Some total stations have an auto power save features. Power saving modes are there, and which switches the instrument off or into some standby mode after it has been not been used for a specified time. The just like your calculator, it will be having a auto power off mode, auto power saver mode. So after 5 minutes not using, it will reduces the display unit so that power supply can be saved. Next, reflector. I am explaining about the reflector, where which point you have to measure, and there you have to put the reflector. The special form of reflector known as a corner cube prism or furrow prism, we will call it as a furrow prism, which is a pole mounted or maybe tripod mounted, is used as a target. So target is also important, and this prism itself costs about 10,000 to 15,000. And these are constructed from glass cubes or blocks, and they return a beam along a path exactly parallel to the incident path over a range of angles of incidence of about 20 degrees to the normal of the front face of the prism. So whatever may be the angle the ray it was reaching, it will be reflected back in the same line, even though at 20 degrees angle incidence is there. As a result, the alignment is not critical and is quickly set when making observations. So exactly the eyepiece cross mark is not required to put the on the prism, center of the prism. At the any place of the prism, if you put, the rays will be reflected back to your idiom. Next. There are several types of total stations are available in the market. Some of them are noted at here, that is Pentax, Topcon, Nikon, Leica, Sokia, Trimble, and so many companies are there. I think latestly economical instrument is there, that is called South, prepared by the China. About 1.5 lakhs will get that total station, and all these Pentax, Topcon will be having 3 to 4 lakhs cost. Minimum instrument cost is 3 to 4 lakhs. And Sokia and Leica will be having a very good one, will be having a cost about 5 to 6 lakhs, Leica. And so many modern instruments are available in the market. In our college, we'll be having Topcon and Trimble. Topcon 3 numbers and Trimble. Topcon 4 numbers and Trimble will be about 2 numbers are there. 4 plus 2, 6 numbers are available. And least count and accuracy of the instrument. The least count of the instrument may be, we can measure distance up to 1 millimeter on the display unit. However, the accuracy will be only 2 mm plus 2 ppm based on distance, where D is the distance. Based on distance, the accuracy will be varied. Minimum 2 mm, or it can read up to 2 mm. But display will be 1 mm. And angle will also be measurable up to 1 second. But accuracy of the instrument is only 5 seconds. So it can read up to 1 mm, 1 second. But actually, the instrument will be having an accuracy of only 5 seconds. Please find the least count is different and accuracy is different for the instruments. And the accessories of a total station will be a wooden tripod prism prism holder, prism pole, prism pole and stand, prism pole stand, tri-batch with optical or laser plummet, tri-batch adapter, and rough compass. Rough compass is to measure the approximate north direction, so that bearings can also be measured by using this rough compass. So the instrument can be oriented towards azimuth, north direction, so that bearings can be measured. After getting directed, then we can set the angle, horizontal angle, to zero, so that with reference to that one, you can measure the. Next is a battery. Battery charger is provided, and a downloading cable with a downloading software toolkit. It's provided with a toolkit. Next slide. Now we'll see what are the capabilities of a total station. What can do by the total station? Total station computes coordinates. That coordinates means longitude, latitude, and altitude can be calculated by using the total station. Data can be collected in the form of a longitude, latitude, altitude. That is the NEZ mode. The instrument can be shifted to NEZ mode, point data collection mode. Then the data will be collected in the form of longitude, latitude, and altitude with reference to the starting station as well as the reference station. These values can be displayed on the screen and can also be stored into the instrument memory by using the memory card, or maybe by using the pen drive, or maybe internal memory is there. About 1,000 points can be recorded in the internal memory. And traverse closer and adjustment, which can be done as like the theodolite traversing, traverse closing can be done. That means control stations can be established by using these total stations, and adjustments can be made. And topographic reductions, that is leveling, can also be performed. And remote object elevation. So remote object elevation can be found out without going to the top of the building. By reaching to the bottom of the building, can able to estimate the elevation of the top of the building also. Distance between remote points. So sometimes one point is on the top of the hill and another point is on the bottom of the hill. And there is some obstacles between those two points. You can able to measure directly remote. These remote points can be directly measurable if the instrument from the instrument station, these two points are visible to you. That means reciprocal ranging or reciprocal leveling may be avoided. Directly you can find the elevation between the two points. And the next is inversing and resection. Resection means locating your instrument station with reference to the known points which has been already taken. That means if you start today work and taken so many points, tomorrow your instrument station has been disturbed. That means tomorrow morning you got the instrument to the site and your peg point is not there. You can able to obtain your peg point by the resection method. And horizontal and vertical collimation corrections can be made. And you can setting can make the setting out works, that is a curve setting, building setting out can be done by using the total station. Vertical circle indexing can be done. That means corrections can be made, vertical circle. And records search and review. So whatever may be the records, files stored inside of the instrument can be searched, and it can be reviewed, whether it can be deleted or maybe transferred to the system can be done. Onboard software is available with the instrument itself. So by using this onboard software, it will work, and transfer of data to the computer. So from the instrument, data can be transferred to the computer, and vice versa. From the computer also, the data can be transferred. Transfer of computer files to the data recorder. So from the computer also, the data can be transferred to the instrument. From that one, you can able to prepare the setting out. These are the capabilities of a total station. And now we'll see the applications of total station. Total station is a representative modern surveying instrument meant for taking angles, distances, and coordinates. The following are the some of the applications you can see. First one is angle measurement. The following functions are available for angle measurement. Measure the horizontal angle between two points. That is, in the theodolite, we are doing the repetition method. Can be performed. set the horizontal circle to required value. That is a horizontal hold. By applying the horizontal hold, you can set wherever horizontal circle to 0 degrees. Horizontal angle display selection, right to left, swing right or swing left. That is clockwise or anti-clockwise. You can also measure in the anti-clockwise direction also. Horizontal angle repetition can be done. That is as like in the repetition method. Slope in percentage and vertical angle measurement. Slope can also measured in percentage, like 1 in 40, 1 in 50, like that one. Or vertical angle can be measured. Regarding this angle measurement, distance measurement, in electronic distance measurement mode, we can select slope distance, horizontal distance, and height difference. Both sloping distance, height difference is nothing but vertical distance, and horizontal distance can also be measured by using the instrument. The distance is generally expressed in one unit, and it can be shifted to one unit to another unit. It will be having a unit mode, so that from the meters to feet or centimeters or millimeters, it can be changed on the screen itself. Normally, it is expressed in meters. And the distance and angles are most recently are stored in the memory. The distance and angle which you have displayed on the screen will be in a memory, short-term memory. And if you take the next reading, automatically this display will spoils. If otherwise you have stored them in a file. So normal practice, normally it is a practice to keep horizontal distance measurement for distance measurement activity. The measured distance is from the instrument station to the target station. If the single measurement or the average measurement mode has been selected, the measurement stops automatically. So once you can take or several times you can take and make the average of it. So automatically, if you put that function, so it will measure and stops automatically. So then the data will be displayed on the screen. The distance and angle measured most recently are stored in the memory until the power is switched off. And next mode of measurement is coordinate data. The instrument calculates the dimensional coordinates of the prism position by inputting the instrument height, target height, and instrument station coordinates, and by measuring the slope distance, the horizontal angle, and the vertical angle of the prism position. For you, I think this should be clearly understandable. From the principle I had explained, so you have to give the input data, two items. One is instrument height, second one is reflector height. So instrument station point data should be given. That is coordinates of the instrument station, X, Y, and Z. Z is the elevation with reference to the mean sea level. The benchmark, with reference to the benchmark, you can transfer the point. So elevation and as well as the coordinates of the point. Generally, you should not give 0, 0. Coordinates shall not be 0, 0. So if you give 0, 0, if the point is on the left of you, then you will get the minus values. Most probably, it is not preferable. So give some positive values for the station point. Let us say 1000, 1000. That means assume it as a 0, 0, 1000, 1000. So with reference to that one, if you move in the backward direction, then you will get the 900 or so. And if you move in the forward direction, you will get the positive values. So elevation may be measured with reference to the benchmark, or it may be temporary, or maybe arbitrary benchmark, or maybe permanent benchmark. With reference to the mean sea level, the benchmark value is given. That is Z value. So XYZ of the station A will be given, as well as the instrument height and reflector height. These points are supplemented. Then with reference to this one, the second point coordinates, that is XYZ values, X1, Y1, Z1 will be automatically displayed on the screen.
Class chupta na rada.
Hello. by using the coordinate data, we can prepare a contour map. Also, the readings can be stored depending on the model and make of the instrument. The range will be generally 900 to 10,000 readings. So a simple instrument can store the coordinate data of about 900 to 10,000 readings. And next one. Now we'll see the what are the inbuilt programs in the instrument. That is remote elevation measurement. To obtain elevation of the part, you can see the figure in the next page. So remote elevation measurement will be done like this one. This is a total station instrument is kept, and the prism is kept at the bottom of the building, just touching to the corner of the building with reference to the instrument. The instrument first prism is calibrated with the vertical axis, keeping the vertical axis horizontal, and then the vertical circle is rotated to the to see that crosshairs are coincided with the top of the building automatically, and the display unit, the height of the building including the height of the prism, is calculated and given on the instrument display unit. So directly, without going to the top of the building, by reaching the bottom of the building, you can able to calculate the height of the building. And second application of the instrument, built-in programs are there in the instruments. Missing line measurement. So you can able to measure the two points which are not accessible directly between those two points. I can see the example. The figure, suppose at here, A and B are the two points which are at a different elevations and some distance apart. If you want to find the distance from A to B, and both horizontal distance as well as height difference in elevation can also be found out by using the missing line measurement. So by keep the prism at A first, observe the calibrate it with reference to the instrument station, and then keep the prism at B point, you can able to understand the what is the distance between the two points and elevation difference between the A and B. So there will be two modes in missing line measurement mode. That is A to B with reference to A, you can measure the several points, A to B, A to C, A to D, like that one, you can measure with reference to A. That is as like in the plane table radiation method, you can measure with reference to A, all the points can be measured. And in the MLM2 mode, you will be having A to B, B to C. That is a traversing mode, nothing but a traversing mode. A to B, B to C can be measured, C to D, D to E, E to A. So a traverse can be concluded by using the MLM2 method, and from that one we can have a display as will be slope distance, horizontal distance, and elevation difference can be displayed on the display unit. So that with reference to first one will work with reference to A only, second one with reference to previous station, the current station will be evaluated. Next, by using the program area calculation, you can able to calculate the area. Just you have to keep the prism at every corner. Suppose a trench is there, you have to find out the area of this trench, or a area of a land can also be easily find out by using the area program. Please keep the prism at the point A, B, C, D, four corners, one by one. After reaching A, please plus measure and record the value. And please keep the prism on the B point, and again sight it, and measure the distance from instrument station to P. And similarly, C and D. After measuring C, the area will be displayed, because A, B, C will form as a triangle. The triangle area is displayed. After measuring D, you can get the total area of the trench easily. So directly, area can be obtained in square meters, and it can be converted into square feet or maybe hectares also. This is the applications of the total station. Besides this one, already have told that data collection can be done by using the total station data collection. It is a coordinate measurement. By using the coordinates, you can able to draw the contour map or any other thing. Contour map can be prepared. From that one, route survey can be prepared, and all the works can be performed. That is, canal alignment of canal can be done, and road works can be taken up. Bridges can be constructed by using that data. Dams can also be constructed by using the coordinate measurement data. So this is regarding the total station. If you have any queries, you can ask. I hope regarding total station, I had explained to the possible extent whatever may be the instrument and its capabilities, as well as its principle of EDM, as well as electronic distance measurement, that is EDM, how it will operate and how the principle will work, and how the angles will be measured, and how the coordinate data can be collected. All this point I had explained, and also applications, that is REM, remote elevation method, and missing line measurement, and area applications will be there. So all these applications, which are built-in programs provided in the instrument, by using these programs, a simple calculate without going for any calculation, we can find the data values. So area of the land, missing line distances, as well as the elevations of the points, buildings can be found out very clearly. Those are the applications. With that, I hope that I concluded the total station. Now we'll go for the GPS for next half an hour. Please stay online. I'll take a minute break. Take water. Okay. Once again, please resign. Our next topic is global positioning system. An introduction. Just I am introducing. I am not going for the corrections, etc. So this will be what is meant by global positioning system. How it will be useful for the surveying. I will explain briefly. And with this data, advanced surveying can be proceeded forward. Okay. Hello, Harish.
How many sir, tell me, sir.
Okay. Are you clear?
Voice is clear.
Voice is clear. Presentation is clear.
Yes, yes sir. Voice presentation is clear.
I have to change anything. Shall I enter to the full mode?
Full yes, screen. Sir. Full screen will be good, sir.
Okay. Security alert. Okay. Okay.
Now it is clear, sir.
Okay. One problem is there that whenever they are listening on the mobiles, very large screen will be difficult. Put in the horizontal mode. Okay.
Okay, sir.
I will go for the global positioning system. My first question is, where on earth am I? That means, if you are in your home now, today is COVID is running, so you are in your home, you can give your address, your residential address, so and so house number, so and so street number, etc. But if I will leave you in a forest, now I will ask you, where are you? Can you give your address? It is not possible because your location cannot be shared very easily. But however, with your smart mobile phone, today you are sharing your location even though you are lying in the forest also. If the signals are available, you can share your location. How it is possible? Do you know it? How it is possible? With the GPS, this is possible. GPS is nothing but stands for global positioning system. Your address is shareable now very easily to your family members or to your friends so that they can easily approach you and save you from any difficulties. And also, it is very easy. Nowadays, the delivery system of this Amazon, etc. is very easily delivering and knowing your address very easily because of the GPS. So now we are studying very important topic, that is a global positioning system. GPS is a shortened form of Navstar. Its full name is Navstar GPS. Navstar acronyms for navigation system with the time and ranging global positioning system. Navstar stands for navigation system with the time and ranging global positioning system. It is its full form. We are in a shorter form, we are calling it as GPS. Its full name is Navstar GPS. What is meant by global navigation satellite system? GNSS, we will call it as a global navigation satellite system. A standard generic term of satellite navigation systems that provide autonomous geospatial positioning with global coverage. So it is a standard generic term for satellite navigation systems that provide autonomous geospatial positioning with global coverage. So entire globe is covered by this GNSS. Using a GNSS system, the following values can accurately be determined anywhere on the globe. So main advantage with this GNSS system is the accurate values of the location can be determined anywhere on the globe. So what are those? Exact position. Your exact position, longitude, latitude, and altitude coordinates. You know what is meant by longitude and latitude? That is on the globe, it has been marked. Longitudes and latitudes are marked. Horizontal and vertical lines, longitudes and latitudes. And altitude is the mean sea level. With reference to the mean sea level, whatever may be the elevation is measured, that is known as altitude. Accurate to And these values are accurate up to 20 meters to approximately 1 millimeter. Maximum, more accurately means 1 millimeter can give solution, and approximately means 20 meters. Based on the instrument, measuring instrument you are having, the accuracy will depend. The cost of the GPS provider, GPS receiver, will make it as 20 meters to as much as 1 millimeter. Suppose if you are using a GPS in an aeroplane, it may be costing 20 lakhs, then it will give an accuracy up to 1 millimeter. Suppose you are using GPS in your smart mobile phone, maybe costing around 200 rupees, it can give approximately 20 meters right or left to your point, exact point. So hence, exactness will depend upon the cost of the instrument and software it was using. And based on the instrument capabilities, you can get the accuracy and procedure you are adapting to get the accurate value. So all these points should be remembered, and exact time, universal time coordinate, UTC. Exact time is also accurate to within 60 nanoseconds to approximately 0.5 seconds. Earlier, the time will be displayed in the radio stations exactly, and that will be transmitted to you by the operator telling that the time in our radio station is exactly 9 o'clock 15 seconds, like that one. So now at that time we are adjusting the clocks, our wall clocks or maybe wrist watches are adjusted to that time. But nowadays we are not making the adjustments in the clocks, because the clocks are more exactly adjusted by the UTC, universal time coordinates, time coordinated and accurate. These are measured with reference to the GPS. Almost all smart phones, mobile phones will be having a GPS. So once if you switch on the GPS, automatically your time will be synchronized with the UTC, so that all the mobile phones will shows the same timing. Unless otherwise, if there is an error in the instrument, that error, with that error, the time may not be correct. But more exactly, including seconds, the times are all automatically adjusted in the mobile phones. And you can see how much accuracy is there with the GPS. The time is 60 nanoseconds to approximately 0.5 nanosecond. Nanosecond means 10 to the power of minus 9 seconds. 60 into 10 to the power of minus 9 seconds. Up to that fraction, the time is accurate. Up to maximum of 0.5 nanoseconds. So again, it is also based on your instrument. So have you understand? Two things will be there: longitude, latitude, altitude, as well as time is also corrected by the GPS. So already GNSS means Global Navigation Satellite System is presented by the various countries in the world. Current global navigation systems are there: GPS by the America and GLONASS by Russia. Proposed global navigation system, some of them are now working, that is COMPASS of China and DORIS of France and Galileo Europe. IRNSS, Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System, about 7 satellites has been sent already, and a few more has to be sent for complete working of the IRNSS, and PIS, Japan. So these are the individually they are proposing. However, fully functional and working is GPS is in the world. GPS is proposed by the United States Global Positioning System, which has as of 2009 is only fully functional, fully available global navigation satellite system. For this system, it consists of 32 medium Earth orbit satellites in 6 different orbital planes, with the exact number of satellites varying as older satellites are retired and replaced. So it has been fully functional with the 32 medium Earth orbit satellites, and older will be replaced with the newer one. Operational since 1978 and globally available since 1994. So it has been operated from 1978 and fully operationable from 1994. GPS is currently the world's most utilized satellite navigation system. So we are all using this satellite navigation system, GPS. Every day, every time we are using this one, because the time which is given by the GPS is using by you. That means every day, every minute, we are using the GPS. Now we'll see what are the advantages of GPS. Relatively high positioning accuracies are the advantages. That means what you have to find out in the survey, the positioning, where we are, which point you have to go. Suppose a road is laid between two cities, Hyderabad to Bangalore. How it will go? So highly positioning accuracies will be available. So what is the position of Hyderabad location? And what is the position of the Bangalore? What is the distance between them? How we have to go? Next is the capability of determining velocity and time. Suppose an aeroplane is started from Chicago. It may reach to Hyderabad. Chicago to Hyderabad. I think the flight is there from Chicago to Hyderabad. However, let us say Chicago to Hyderabad, it will take 24 hours time. So exactly what time it will reach us can be displayed on the Hyderabad airport. How it is possible? Because based on the velocity it was traveling, the time taken can be estimated based on the distance. So all are programmable so that the velocity it was traveling, let us say it was traveling at 600 kilometers per hour, 700 kilometers per hour, for example. So the distance between the Chicago and the Hyderabad may be around 12,000 kilometers. So 600 kilometers per hour means it will take 20 hours time. With a break, suppose a break is there at the Dubai for filling the fuel, 2 hours break is there. So it will take 22 hours. The time can be calculated based on the velocity and the stopping times, etc. It can calculate this exact time. So signal availability to users. So main advantage with the GPS is signal is available to the all the users. All over the world, no user charges. Next main advantage is suppose you are using Airtel phone, you have to pay the for Airtel phone charges. Phone charges are there, and low cost hardware. So it may be costing just 200 rupees. Hence, all the smart mobile phones, even though the instrument is only 2000 rupees, it will be having a GPS built inside of it. No user charges. That means. It is not charged, and it is a all weather system. So this GPS will work in summer season, winter season, rainy season. Even rain is falling, this will work because this will work based on the principles of the radio signals. That's why it can work all weather system and three dimensions. So it can give the location with reference to the three dimensions. That is X, Y, Z. Three values will be given. Next, components of a GPS. I will briefly explain these components and conclude right there. Please stay on there because three components will be taking 5 minutes each. So space segment, all operational satellites will be the space segment, and the control segment, all ground stations involved in the monitoring of the system. Master control stations, monitor stations, ground control stations. User segment will be all civilian and military users. So total GPS system will be divided into three parts. One is space segment, control segment, user segment. Users are ourselves as well as military. Military fellows and space segments means all the operational satellites. Control segments are these satellites are operated from the ground control stations, as well as the data from the satellites will be collected by the ground control stations, and their orbital data will be controlled by the ground control stations. Hence, these ground control stations should be there all over the world, located all over the world. So that all the satellites can be visible at any one time of the day. So that all the times of the day. So each satellite will be working under any one control station, at least. Then only it can be controlled, its position. Its positional data can be available. Now I had shown with a figure. This is a space segment. All operational satellites is the space segment, and it will be interaction with the ground control station. The data from the satellite is transmitted to the ground control stations. At the same time, its orbital data may be controlled, where in which orbit this satellite should be there, and in whatever may be the velocity of the satellite, because it is orbiting the Earth at a constant speed. Its velocity is controlled by the ground control station. That is established ephemeris, calculator almanacs, satellite health, time corrections will be sent from the ground control station to the satellites. And satellites will send their own position, and their orbital data will be sent to the ground control station. So there is an interaction between the space segment and the ground control stations. Satellites will give the information about them to the control stations, and these control stations will be operated by the human beings. So they will give the signals to the space segment based on the calculations. Their orbital data will be adjusted. But on the other hand, user segment is there. Aeroplanes, cars, ships, motorcycles, or taxis, trains, buses, all will be operated using the user segment. All will come under user segment. Even if you put your mobile phone in your pocket, you are also comes under this user segment. And for this one, satellite will transmit the data from the satellite, and you will be having a receiver. Just like a radio station, space segment act as a radio station, and your instrument will act as a radio receiver. So what will be carried by the satellites is L1 carrier signals, time pulses, ephemeris, almanac, satellite health, diet, and time. This will be transmitted from the space segment to the user segment. Now we'll see briefly about the what is meant, what is the space segment. Consists of 32 operational satellites and orbit at a height of 20,180 kilometers. That is high altitude satellites above the Earth's surface and are inclined at 55 degrees to the equator. Each satellite is inclined at 55 degrees to the equator. Any one satellite completes its orbit around 12 hours, and due to the rotation of the Earth, a satellite will be in its initial starting position above the Earth's surface after approximately 24 hours. That is 23 hours, 56 minutes, exactly one day. One day it will complete one orbit. So they may be moving at 11,000 kilometers per hour. I think so. Velocity is about 11,000 kilometers per hour. Because they are lying at 20,180 kilometers above the surface of the Earth, and you have to take the consideration of the diameter of the Earth, about 12,000 kilometers. So for completion of the one revolution, it may take 24 hours. 12 hours exactly, and at the same time, Earth will also be rotating. So to complete revolution, to get the same position, exactly 24 hours will be there. Now you can see the satellite positioning. The blue point at here indicates your position. The green lines indicates the satellites which are visible to you. Visibility is given with a number. So red one is not visible to you. Red satellites which are on the back of the Earth, which are not visible to you. So your receiver cannot receive signals from those red satellites. From the black satellites, you can receive the signals with the green lines. Hope GPS satellites orbiting the Earth in six planes. It was orbiting six planes, and each plane, four satellites are there. So at any time, you can observe that 7 to 8 satellites are visible to you. At any time. One complete revolution, I will show it to you. So at here, 10, maximum 10, 12 satellites may be available. Minimum is 6. Minimum is 6 or 7 at any time. Hence, you can easily get the data from at least 6 satellites anywhere. Basic functions of the space segment, what the satellites will do to receive and store data transmitted from the control segment stations. So they will receive the control data transmitted from the control segment to maintain accurate time and by means of several onboard atomic clock. Here is a very important point. Each satellite will be having 5 to 6 atomic clocks inbuilt on the onboard. The main function of the total this GPS is to transmit the time coordinates, because with reference to time only, its distance will be calculated. Hence, time will be exacted by using the atomic clock. You know that your wristwatch may be costing around 5,000 rupees, good one, Titan make, maybe 10,000. also. Hello. If highest cost I had seen 1.5 lakhs on net, your wristwatch may be 1.5 lakhs. If it is gold plated, it may be 3 lakhs or so maximum. But this atomic clock costing around 50 lakhs each has been provided in it. The main purpose of these atomic clocks is it will give the more exact time. The error with the clock of 1 second may be taken place in 10,000 years or so. So there is no error, simply you can say. There is no error with this atomic clocks. So to transmit information and radio signals to users on two L-band frequencies, L1, L2, two bands. So transmission of radio signals is done by each satellite in two L-band frequencies. You know what is meant by L-band, L-band, S-band, like that bands are there for the transmission of the frequencies. To maintain a stable platform and orbit for the L-band transmitters. So it acts as a transmitter station, like a radio station, it will act as a transmitter station. And the signals from GPS satellites will transmit two frequencies, L1 and L2. L1 will be having a carrier wave, 19 centimeters wavelength. This is the electronics data, 1227 megahertz frequency navigation. And carries a coarse acquisition code, CA code, and precise code. It will transmit the two codes, CA code and P code. P code is utilized by the only US military, and CA code is available for all users. CA code will give the rougher positioning, approximate position. Your position can be given by the CA code. And the L2 carrier wave will be having 24 centimeters wavelength and 1775 megahertz. It will be working. It consists of a P code, which is encrypted. Encrypted means which can be openable only for the military use of the US military. Unusable by civilian with one receiver, but is usable when performing differential correction between two or more receivers used by the military navigation message called ephemeris, tells where the satellites are located with respect to WGS-84 coordinates. WGS-84 is the coordinate system which has been following from the 84, standardized in 1984. With reference to that one, the navigation message called as ephemeris will be provided by the satellites. This can be encrypted when two or more receivers are provided by you and used by military navigation message. So what will be there? GPS message will be, what will be transmitted from the satellite is a continuous stream of data transmitted at 50 bits per second. Each satellite lays following the information to Earth. System time and clock correction values, its own high accurate orbital data called as ephemeris, its own orbital data can be given, and approximate orbital data for all other satellites, that is called almanac. All other satellites data will be received from the ground control station, will also be transmitted by the instrument. System health of the satellite will also be transmitted. The navigation message is needed to calculate the current position of the satellite and to determine the signal travel times. So this navigation message, based on this navigation message, your receiver will calculate the system position, that is where the satellite is there with reference to satellite, what is the distance can be calculated by the your receiver. That message will be transmitted by the these are all regarding the technicality of the electronics, how it will work. We'll skip this one. Structure of navigation message, we'll skip. Next, the control segment. Second part, I'm going to second part, and the last part will be there. Just 10 minutes, I will conclude. The functions of the control segment. Observing the movement of the satellites and computing orbital data. So control segments are the ground control stations, or maybe satellite control stations. They will calculate the movement of the satellites and compute orbital data. Ephemeris, we'll call it as a ephemeris. Please read this one once. Ephemeris. and monitoring the satellite clocks and predicting their behavior. So it will also monitor the satellite clock, health of the clock, predicting their behavior, how it was working, whether it is working good or not, and the synchronizing onboard satellite time. So synchronizing onboard satellite time, that means all the satellites will to clocks will show the same time at the same time. So then only you can have a synchronization between the, all the clocks. Relaying precise orbital data received from satellites. So each one satellite data will be collected by the control segment, and all other data, other satellite data will be transmitted to each and every satellite, so that each one satellite will knows where is the other satellite exactly. So with reference to that one, you can able to calculate the distances. Relaying the approximate orbital data of all satellites, that is called almanac. Relaying further information including satellite health, clock errors, etc. Oversees the artificial distortion of signals, and also to control the signal strength. That means whenever the war is there, the signals may be distorted. That means not exactly transmitted from the satellites, because the satellites are controlled by the control segment. Control segment is under the US government. So whenever the military action is there, US military action is there, then this SA will be transmitted. That means selective availability is provided. That means not exact values are given by the satellites, or degrade the system position accuracy by for civil use. So for our use, the signal strength can be reduced by them when the war is occurred. That's why we are providing our own system. The ground control stations are provided like this. The main station is provided at one, Sechavir Air Force Base, Hawaii, second Hawaii Islands, I think, Hawaii Islands, and Cape Carnival, Canaveral, Canaveral, and Ascension Island. Some islands are there in between the Africa and South America. And Diego Garcia, this is also island, and Kwazalian. All these islands are owned by the America, and these ground control stations are protected by the military. These ground control stations are completely protected by the military, and these two, one and three, is there in the America itself. There is no problem, but 2, 4, 5, 6 are located at the out of the America. However, these islands are purchased by them, and control stations are established so that they are covering worldwide. Ground control stations are now covering worldwide. And last segment is a user segment. GPS receivers used to receive the GPS signal for determination of position and time, consisting of an antenna, preamplifier, radio signal microprocessor, control and display device, data recording unit, and power supply. So GPS receiver consists of an antenna, preamplifier, radio signal microprocessor, control and display device, and data recording unit, and power supply. So special instruments are there, GPS instruments, not in your mobile phone. In your mobile phone only it will use the route map. It will not use the coordinate data, most probably. So special instrument which will be having a antenna for receiving the signals, and having a amplifier, so received signals will be amplified. Radio signal microprocessor, so radio signals are obtained from the satellites, and this will be processed by using the microprocessor. And control, it will be having a control display device. It will be having a control and display device, and a data recording unit, and power supply. So what it will do? Decodes the timing signals from the visible satellites, and having calculated the distances, computes its own longitude, latitude, elevation, and time. Four items are calculated by the receiver. By collecting the data from the visible satellites, it will calculate its own latitude, longitude, elevation, and time. So all the three elevation points, that is longitude, latitude, location points, and time will also be coordinated. Hence, fourth dimension is also provided by the GPS. There are four dimensions. One is longitude, latitude, altitude are the three dimensions which we can measure in the survey. But by using the GPS, we can also measure the fourth dimension, that is time. Time is the fourth dimension here. These are the user segments, handheld GPS receiver, handheld GPS receiver. And this is a tripod mounted GPS receiver, stationary. And this is a rover, which can be mounted, antenna is mounted on the vehicle, and vehicle can be moved forward, its location can be measurable. So if you use two instruments, like one is stationary, another one is moving, then we'll call it as a DGPS, differential GPS. Now, the importance are there for the DGPS, differential GPS. A set of two instruments, GPS will be called as, one is fixed and another is rover. Then we'll call it as, both can be exchangeable. Such a pair of GPS are called as DGPS, receivers. Now, our state government, AP state government is started land surveying in January 1st of 2021. They started the land surveying, because all the records available with the registration department will be old one, which has been transferred from the Britishers when they are handovering to our government. So whatever may be the data available with this register office as well as with the survey departments will be old one. So hence all the data available with the government will be very old one, more than 100 years back one. So hence to update the data, our government has planned using DGPS, the survey is carried out. So training is going on for the several engineers from the Sachivalayams as well as the deputy surveyors are there in the survey department, revenue department. So they are doing their level best. Within a short duration of 1 to 2 years, you will get in a new data of which has been prepared by the state government, so that each land is marked with the GPS values. So hence, even though the boundary pillars have been displaced, that can be replaced immediately by the surveyor within a short duration of time. You cannot, earlier it is not there. Now we'll see the what are the levels of accuracy of the receivers. Based on working, autonomous may be having 115 to 100 meters accuracy. That means your mobile phone GPS is having a autonomous, a single one will be having 15 to 100 meters. Even though this handheld GPS will also be having accuracy of 15 to 100 meters, and differential GPS, I said that two numbers will be there having a accuracy of 0.5 to 5 meters. And next type of GPS are real-time kinematic float. 20 centimeters to 1 meter accuracy is there. So this can be used for the ships, etc. Ships and road users can use, heavy buses, trucks will be using this one. And real-time kinematic fixed may be having 1 centimeter to 5 centimeters accuracy. So mobile items with kinematic float, real-time kinematic float, they will use the third variety. Kinematic fixed will be used by the airports, shipyards, etc., ports, etc. And GPS receivers, the basic split of GPS receivers based on the number of satellites the receiver can track at a time. So each tracked satellite requires a channel. So generally, when you put a radio on, only one station can be listened by you at a time. That means it will be having a single tracking. Receivers usually have between 1 and 12 channels. So 12 radio stations cannot be read by you with a single radio. If the receiver will consisting of 12 radios in it, 1 to 12 radios. You can receive the signals from the 12 satellites at a time. That is the capability between 1 to 12 channel radio. So based on that one, the cost of receiver will change us. Because one channel is your mobile phone, and four channels will be having for the DCPS at least. Since four satellites are required for an accurate position, any receiver with less than four channels must necessarily be a sequencing receiver. So less than four channels are there, then sequencing receiver, we will call it as a sequencing receiver. So a sequencing receiver tracks one satellite, drops another until four satellites are received, tracked, then whole process begins again, and then it will give the position. So it takes a few seconds. If you start your GPS in your mobile phone, it will take a few seconds, because it has to track at least four satellites to locate its position. That's why immediately it will not start. If you take the good one having a four channel or six channel one, yeah, it will be started very immediately. So this is regarding the channel, number of channels. It was up to 12 channels it was given. A principle of measuring signal transit time. One calculates position by establishing the distance relative to reference satellites with a known position. The distance is calculated from the travel time of radio waves transmitted from the satellite. So signal is traveled from the satellite to the ground about 67.5 nanoseconds, I think so, exactly. So based on that one, the location of the satellite can be established. So the signals will be traveled at the speed of light, that is 3 lakh kilometers per second. So electromagnetic signals are traveling from the satellite to the receiver. So it is very speed. 20,000 kilometers is very less in this one. So less than a second time, the signal will be received by the receiver. So based on the capability of the receiver, the accuracy will depend. So basic principle of satellite navigation. So signal transmitted will be received by the car. So by that time, it was traveled a distance, received signal. Delta T is the time traveled. So the distance D is calculated by multiplying the travel time, delta T, by the velocity of light, C into D. C, D equal to delta T into C. C is the velocity of the light. So time can be calculated, distance can be easily calculated. A differential, suppose if you get the from 2, it will be exactly corrected. Correction will be there. So at here, you will get the error of this much. When you get the signal from at least two stations transmission, then you will get your exact position. In the case of a satellite navigation system, if you get the signals from four satellites, the error will be eliminated and your exact position can be given. Satellite navigation system uses satellites as time signal transmitters. Contact of at least four satellites is necessary in order to determine the three desired coordinates, longitude, latitude, altitude, as well as the exact time. Four satellites are required minimum for exact location calculation. Signal travel time is given, that already have told that 67.3 milliseconds are required to get the signal from the satellite to the receiver. And based on its location, receiver location, this may be changed by 3 or 4 milliseconds, fractional milliseconds. The signal requires 3.33 microseconds for each additional kilometer of travel. So based on that one, your location will be exactly calculated. So signal travel time is exacted by 67.3 milliseconds. Milli means 10^-3. 10^-3, 67.3 into 10^-3 seconds. So if only two satellites are there, you can get XY position. Intersection of these two circles will give the XY position. If four satellites are there, four are intercepted at here and the ground point. So that gives the exact position. Satellite triangulation. So how the satellites will be there? So the effect of correction of time and error will be there. This will not go very deeper. So from one station like this, four satellites are visible at least. Then only you'll get the accurate position, 5 to 10 meters. So applications of GPS. Now we'll go for the applications. Location determines a basic position. Where am I? That is a question at the beginning. Navigation, getting from one location to another. Where I am going? Tracking, monitoring the movement of people and things. Suppose a GPS is attached to your collar by your parent. You may be tracked wherever you are there, as shown in the pictures. Your mobile phone will also be able, if your GPS is on, then we can track your mobile phone. So mapping, creating maps of the world. Next is timing, bringing a precise timing to the world. When will it all happens? Where is everything else? Mapping can be, where is everything else? GPS based, how it is useful for the surveying based on earth moving. So typical site vision systems will be there. So that by using the satellites positioning, exact base stations can be established. And site vision supervision can be done where your earth mover is working in the night time also, where it was working. Suppose you targeted a 300 meters to the driver and you go and sleep in your position. GPS is attached to your earth mover, so that how much work done you can know by midnight, 1 o'clock, where is the instrument, you can find out. And while using for the earth mover, exact depth can be fixed for the blade. Blade direction can also be adjustable. The depth can be fixed by fixing the antenna to the blade, GPS antenna. Exact depth can be fixed. Next is automatic vehicle location in vehicle equipment. If you provide a GPS in the vehicle, from the satellites, it will receive the signal and its location may be transmitted to the owner by SMS, simply. SMS, by SMS, owner will receive. Suppose if you put every half an hour, a program is fixed in the mobile GPS unit, every half an hour, it will transmit a SMS to the owner where its location is there, exact location. So that owner can easily, happily sleep in his bed. The vehicle is moving. If vehicle is stopped for lunch or dinner, can also be known by the owner. Fleet management service can be provided. Internet-based user interface will be there. Internet, by using the internet. GPS and total station. Last but one. So with the GPS, we can obtain the data, that is longitude, latitude, altitude. So the ground station point A, which has I had shown in the figure, the coordinates of the point A can be established by using GPS. With reference to that one, your survey work, remaining survey work will be carried out with reference to the GPS coordinates. That is the main advantage, the interlinking of the GPS data with the total station. Global positioning system can give position of a point anywhere on the globe with high accuracy. GPS can measure baselines for high accuracy. It controls points without any line of sight requirement. No need for control points. Long traverses and resections can be eliminated. GPS determines the position. Real-time kinematic GPS determines the position to centimeter accuracy within a few seconds at ranges up to 100 kilometers from reference station. With GPS total station, it is possible to go to the shortest possible time to fix the positions of the GPS and to survey the totals with the total station. And these are the references. And one textbook is there, I think. Satish Gopi is available in the market, Global Positioning System Principles and Application, published by the Tata McGraw-Hill publication, about 350 rupees, I think so. This is only the complete textbook about GPS is available. Okay, with this, I can conclude my presentation. Thank you, Harish, for giving the opportunity.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable time.
Okay.
Vote of thanks, you can.
Sir,
any Hello? Queries you have, students?
Sir, yes, sir, I have few questions.
Yes, ask your questions, no problem.
How long does a subdivision take, sir?
What? Pardon me?
How long does a subdivision take?
Subdivision?
Yes, sir.
I can't understand your question, what subdivision means. But here is a surveying. You can ask questions on total station or GPS or surveying.
Is there any way to estimate the additional cost of road construction in floodplain, sir?
Road construction.
Is there any way to estimate the additional cost of road construction in floodplains?
I am not exactly understanding your question. By using total station, you can do the surveying. By using GPS, exact coordinates can be obtained. By using coordinates with the GPS, total station survey can be carried out. And by using DGPS, you can prepare the maps.